Really, the Baha'i community of Samoa is a blessing in this country, in the sense that something wonderful is growing here in Samoa, which is, seems to be a natural extension of the Samoan way of life.
I am very honored and privileged to say that I'm proud of our Baha'i community in our islands, in the Samoan Islands, because this great blessedness that we have the House of Worship here, and we have the head of state, the first head of state to be Baha'i. My father is a Baha'i.
The Baha'i Faith was established in the middle of the 19th century in Iran, and in the middle of the 20th century, 1954, the teachings of Baha'u'llah arrived on the shores of Samoa. This Baha'i House of Worship was dedicated in September 1984 and is a gift from the Baha'is of the world to all the people of the world, whatever race and whatever religion.
To be the recipient of such a gift, my sincere and warmest expression of thanks goes to the members of the Baha'i Faith.
This much blessed House of Worship, now opening wide its doors to peoples of all creeds, of all races, of all nations, and of all classes, is dedicated to the three fundamental verities animating and underlying the Baha'i Faith: the unity of God, the unity of His prophets, the unity of mankind.
Samoa is positioned in the heart of Polynesia, and it is the crossroads of people of many cultures coming through and visiting Samoa from Europe, from all parts of the world. We have joyous occasions, we have times when people come together, have fellowship and have fun and enjoy each other's company. I think Samoa is particularly blessed too, because the Samoan people are very receptive to this diversity of culture that exists in the world. They accept it with open arms, with true humility and with true hospitality. They love it. You know, when I first moved to Samoa as a young bride, as a Baha'i, we had many of these people coming through our home from that time. I read an early Persian cookbook which began, "A guest in your home is a gift from God." And I can truly say that every guest in my home has been a gift from God and have enriched our lives so much with what they bring. I now have a Persian husband and Samoan children because they're all born in Samoa. So we're a very international family. We've been very blessed while we've been in Samoa for most of our time here, which are close to 25 years, to have lived in the vicinity of the House of Worship.
The Samoan way of life is really to entertain your guests and to give them as much as you would wish to give them, to make them happy. And it seems that with the Baha'i community, that hospitality has been extended to include not only the Samoan relatives and Samoan people and its neighbors, but to all the members of the human family. It also extends to more than just entertaining and having them in their homes, but really creating in Samoa a way in which they can practically live together and worship together. We are using this great edifice, the Baha'i House of Worship, to maintain this spirit of unity in having Sunday worships.
It's really when we're worshiping God that our heart is at rest and we are able to connect with what is important in our life. This is an important facet of the Baha'i House of Worship, at each of the services that are conducted weekly. There are the readings from each of the major religions of the world. There is one Creator. God is one. We, as the human race, are one race. And all these religions have been revealed successively through the ages from our one Creator. The Baha'i Charitable Trust for Social and Economic Development was established in the 1980s by the National Spiritual Assembly of the Baha'is of Samoa. This Baha'i Charitable Trust has been set up to provide an avenue of service for the Baha'is within the community to work in the wider community in ways that will bring improvement to various aspects of life, for example, education and health.
We have our Baha'i Charitable Trust serving the outer community, like our Montessori school. A lot of our prominent people have their children come to the school.
This school was set up as a preschool and has educated so many wonderful young souls through the years since then.
So we started the Baha'i Montessori School and became very successful. And there was a need to extend that experience to all the local villages here in Samoa. By that time, we already had several Baha'i children's classes operating in the outer local village communities here in Samoa under the auspices of our local Baha'i communities.
The focus of the education program within this Montessori Baha'i preschool is service. Service to humanity. The children are taught at a very early age to serve each other, to serve their parents, and to serve the community in which they live. Other than the three R's, which are a part of the curriculum, reading, writing, and arithmetic, at the level of preschool understanding, this aspect of service is very important.
For the time being, the major thrust of the Charitable Trust is to develop what we term as Baha'i education to give to the children of Samoa. And it's very much as a basis, development of morals, which we see as a need of society today. That people need to base their developments on morals, on what is value of human life, and like the attributes has been the basis of upbuilding and advancing civilization, of love, mercy, honesty, truthfulness, faithfulness, loyalty. All of these are seen as the very basis of socio-economic development. And we want as early as possible, when the individuals just started their life on this earth, to have this very much a foundation of their development.
But I think one of the unique aspects of these schools is the virtues program. It's teaching virtues to children, helping them to understand the love, kindness, obedience, all the virtues that are taught in the holy scriptures, to help the children understand and recognize what these virtues look like, how they can be shown within their lives. This is a training that begins at birth, actually. But sometimes parents have trouble. Parents find it a challenge to teach some of these virtues, and this school is helping them to do this.
And as well as that, His Highness, the head of state, has always been expressing this wish to the Samoan Baha'i community that I need to see more schools being built, so that we can have more of the children of Samoa learning these wonderful teachings of Baha'u'llah about unity, about love, about extending that unity to include all the children and the people of the world.
The Baha'i Charitable Trust at this time is focused on producing a series of television cook shows.
With respect to food, which is a good part of our Samoan way of life, food is it's really a strong aspect of our way we live and develop.
1998, I was talking with the head of the nutrition center in the health department at the hospital, who was very concerned about the nutrition of children. So many children were coming into the hospital malnourished, and it was obvious to the nutrition center that children in the villages, even if they weren't presenting at the hospital, were having problems with their diet. They were showing in their health. The television cook shows are teaching the people to value their traditional foods, which are far more nutritional than the introduced foods that are coming into the country, are a drain on their economies within the families, whereas they can get all the nutrition that they need from what is grown here in Samoa that will produce wonderful, healthy children to carry Samoa into the 21st century. We started to look for a cook and found our king cooker, Sumeo, a well-known comedian who has very kindly hosted these shows. Each show will be interviewing a well-known Samoan and asking them what their favorite food was as they grew up. Of course, we would hope that it will be a Samoan food, which usually it is. They have something that they're particularly fond of. And in this way, we show the children what is good to eat. We hope that this series of shows, television cook shows, which has the support of so many NGOs in the country, the New Zealand government has helped, UNICEF and AusAid have helped, ASOP has helped from Australia, the nutrition centre at the hospital, and the assistance given by so many wonderful souls who have been able to help with the directing of these cook shows, the editing of the cook shows, the equipment that was needed to edit. There's so many ways that people have come together, put their minds, their hearts together to make this a reality.
He has no idea what it is. He looks at it.
Whenever I've got time for, I'll quickly dash and get something to eat, and then I'll come back and go straight to work.
In Samoan.
Through its beginning, but the Baha'i community had been very much tried to inspire village life in the sense that we as Baha'is try to bring a more sense of community development that would include the participation and the contribution of every individual in the Samoan way of life. And I mean having all the ages, the children, the youth, and the women especially, together with the men, involved in making decisions on how they should rule themselves and develop the different aspects of community life. This is very much an added idea, a broad idea of community development in the Samoa, or the Fa'asamoa way of life, in which in the Fa'asamoa, it's mainly the village councils who makes the decisions of how life should be, of what people should be following, what are the standards, the norms, and the way of life in Samoa. But for the Baha'is to come in and extend those opportunities.
Malietoa.
kindly convey to His Highness Malietoa Tanumafili II our loving greetings and best wishes on the occasion of his birthday, his magnificent record of devoted service to the people of Samoa has deeply impressed us and has won our profound admiration. Our prayers will be offered for him in the holy shrines, the Universal House of Justice.
It's worth to note that in all the communities of the world, this is the country where its head of state is the Baha'i, which is a very high recognition of the Samoan Baha'i communities throughout the world. We are aware of those privileges we have as a Samoan Baha'i community. We believe also, as in the writings of Baha'u'llah, that the time will come when there will be more recognition of the faith by the heads and the leaders of the world. But for these few years and few decades where we have His Highness, the head of state of Samoa, we are so blessed to have him as a member of the Baha'i community and also to support the way the community has developed. He was an active participant in the selection of the place for the House of Worship and the laying of the cornerstone, the dedication of the House of Worship, and as well as promoting the Baha'i Faith as a recognized religious and socio-economic community here in Samoa, in Parliament, and every other aspect of community life at the local level. One of the other developments we are looking at is the youth area. And the Baha'i youth has been strongly involved with the Ministry of Youth and the programs they have. And our emphasis is giving the youth more opportunity to express themselves, to express their talents and their beliefs and their abilities through the arts. So this is the area we feel that the youth are more akin to using the arts to express themselves and to relate to one another and to relate to the parents and to the authorities.
Talofa! We are the Baha'i Youth Workshop. We're going to sing to you something about it. The theme is our environment, our future.
The Baha'i Youth Workshop was established in 1994. This is a group of youth that, through the performing arts, is bringing messages to their peers, to the youth of Samoa, on the various issues and challenges that are facing them in their daily lives: drugs, alcohol, racism, the suicide, and trying to show through the arts that perhaps there's a better way. So rather than focus too on the negative, they're focusing a lot on the positive.
So we are looking into this area and helping other Baha'i youth to go out into the villages and work with youth of all religions. Of course, with maintaining the same basis of the morality that are involved with developing these arts, so that they can develop their abilities in preparation of life as a mature adult, and also in preparation of when they will become part of the institution of the faith. We have always been in Samoa, being much more keen to our own Samoan way of life and the fast Samoa. But as Baha'i youth, we are sort of giving the vision out to the rest of the youth that the Fa Samoa extends to the rest of the Fa'a Lalolangi, or international. We are part of the world community, and that the Fa Samoa is very much a strong part and can contribute very much to the way we are building our world as a better world. This is the area we are giving to the youth as a vision that they can do it, they do it here in preparation of doing it in Africa, in Japan, in New Zealand, wherever they go. They are confident that they are part of the world, that they are Samoan at the same time, but they can do something. They have that confidence as a citizen of the world.
When is Jesus going to come back? Is he ever going to come back while we're still alive? One day my father said, come to the independence service we're going to have at the temple. I said, all right. So I came and I found peaceful. And then when they're reading the prayers, I feel peace in my mind. And then I keep saying to myself, oh, how do you get to become a Baha'i one day? I asked Suhail Alai, how do you become a Baha'i? Because I met Yasi and all these beautiful friends, Ruth, Khosrow. And you know, their ways, they're different. Their faces are different. They look like they have peace. So I became a Baha'i.
I became a Baha'i back in 1981. And during the year, I was attending a college for teacher training. And two Baha'is were teachers there. At that time, my concern religiously is that there should be a renewal of religion. And I came to believe also, based on my upbringing as a Christian, that the only renewal we can have in this world, a total renewal of humanity, is only through the return of Christ. The coming of Christ would be the only time, as he promised that he will come back, that he will bring about this return. So I challenged the Baha'is with this question of, this is what I believe. And they explained to me that Baha'is claim that this return has already been fulfilled, and it's not a material one, but it's more of a spiritual, bringing out a material civilization based on it.
When I was a young girl and lived in Australia, we used to drive by the Mona Vale, the temple in Sydney, Australia. And then I didn't even know that one day I will become a Baha'i.
As a kid, when I was attending intermediate schools, I've been throwing stones at the Baha'i label at the Baha'i Center at Lelata in Apia. And now I'm beginning to ask questions of what this Baha'i faith stands for. And so they explained to me that the Baha'i faith is this family of humanity, or a community of peoples and colors and cultures and different backgrounds coming together to create a better world based on this, what they believe as revealed or divine teachings given by Baha'u'llah, the founder of the faith. So I started reading books and about the faith and investigating their beliefs and their practices. But what really turns me and made me convinced that I should be part of this movement, of this course, is when I read about the history of the early believers of the faith in Iran, when they started teaching the faith of the idea of a new age in which the world will come to be united under one authority, which is an authority created by a universal participation of citizens of the world. And the history of these early believers who started this this faith, it's really marvelous. It really touches my heart when I read about the 10,000s of them that suffered martyrdom and the difficulties they have to face because of their firm belief that this new age is coming and it's going to inevitably established in the world. Eventually, what Baha'u'llah, the prophet founder of the faith, who was part of these beginnings, has to go free for 40 or more years suffering exiles from Tehran, Iran, where the faith started with these early believers, and exiled to Baghdad, to Iraq, to what is now called Turkey, and to eventually to Israel, Palestine, which is all part of the Ottoman Empire during those days. When I look at all those suffering and what they have to go through, and so much blood has been sacrificed on the altar of bringing out the attention of mankind that they are coming into a new age, the age of the maturity of human life, in which man will need to learn to live together in harmony in a very small planet.
I think that this is the most beautiful faith of God and the answer to all the problems. You know, the problems in the world right now, all the answers are here in the Baha'i writings.
Yesterday we had the pleasure and the bounty of attending a Baha'i wedding and the Baha'i Center in Alata.
May I welcome you warmly.
It's a very simple, moving occasion when two young people dedicated themselves to each other for the rest of their lives. There's no clergy, and the Baha'i couple actually, in the presence of witnesses and the Baha'i marriage celebrant, they marry themselves and they have vows that are read and the prayers that are read. The Baha'i marriage is unique. It brings together in unity two families, because not only the girl and the boy who love each other and want to get married, the consent of the parents is important in the Baha'i faith for the union of these two precious souls, and will be a great assistance to the children who will be born of that union.
Thank you for joining us for Baha'i On Air. I hope you'll join us next time.